There's one here. I've not seen one come by all morning.
Now, a number of the people inside... is with you now.
Fresh's followers still holding out. A moment, wouldn't this be a wonderful moment for your son to walk out at this moment? Mrs. Ganim, we've lost Belinda Ganim. We're going to go back to Bonnie Anderson,
Sonia,
Atlanta.
That comes to mind 2-3 weeks ago by one of the members who is now in jail at McLennan County Jail. And in fact, in one of our reports, he said that should the FBI enter the compound, they would see an explosion unlike anything ever seen before. And those were his words. When I asked him and I pressed him on this, he continued to say that he thought it would be from heaven, but he did not discount the possibility that there would be some sort of explosion from the compound itself. Mike, I can see that the flame is
This is in the observation tower, Bonnie. This is where all the messages were hung on the sheets, if you'll remember. And it's completely engulfed in flames, it appears. Now, the whole south side of the building is going up in flames, literally, before our eyes here.
I think we also need to bear in mind that from the very beginning, David Koresh has made it very clear that he was not going to come out and that he was prepared. In fact, we've heard him say this on some of the recorded negotiation sessions with FBI agents that were replayed time and time again over the loudspeakers. He said that he was prepared to die. We don't see anybody coming out of the compound yet. And there has been the concern from the part of the FBI that members would simply not leave if indeed the tear gas was used, as we've seen it has been used.
Correct. And as you point out, David has said time and again that he would not come out. And we still do not see any sort of firefighting equipment out there. So apparently the strategy is to let this thing burn.
Well, and again, among the weapons that are inside the compound, and this comes from the search warrant, are 50 caliber weapons, there are hand grenades, there are a number of different type of concussion grenades. Indeed, some of the agents who were killed and wounded on February 28th indeed were injured by over the last started stockpiling explosives and different devices.
If I could ask our engineers to switch to the camera that we refer to as farm cam, if that's possible, so we can see if the north side of this building has caught fire yet, if that's a possibility. Can we change shots on that now, or we want to stay with this shot? Well, it's bound to have spread. It looks like the whole building is now involved, Bonnie. And this brings up the points that Bob Ricks made in the news conference regarding the structure of the building. Not thought to be structurally sound, and that's proving to be the case here as this fire just completely roars through this building.
Mike, on in the compound, Mr. Jewell's daughter, Reed, as well. Mr. Jewell, what are your thoughts now as you see this?
I'm on the phone to do an interview with CNN. I'm sitting here watching, listening over the telephone and watching the pictures on television, and I'm very, very glad that my daughter is not at home seeing this right now.
Your daughter had a number of stories to report about her training.
Yes.
Can you tell us about that?
Well, she was taught to commit suicide, actually, by Vernon Howell, now known as Dave Koresh, and other members of the compound. They were taught very specifically methods that were better than others. For instance, putting the gun inside your mouth as opposed to beside your head, because there was a chance you might survive if you took a shot in the side of the head.
You have spoken with David Koresh, I believe, for 20 minutes on a phone call, and
yes, on at least one occasion.
What kind of impression did he leave with you? I understand that, you could sense the power that he has against them now.
I believe that those who are inside, as I heard someone else say a few minutes ago, these are, I believe that they were put on a course from which there was no reversing. And as I'm seeing now, the roof's caving in on the buildings. I'm inclined to think that, particularly with Bob Rick's statements this morning, that the tear gas that was being used was a non-pyrotechnic type. My understanding of that would mean that it's a non-flammable type of tear gas, that probably what we're seeing is basically, you might call it the pushing of a self-destruct button. The way that I saw this fire develop, I'm inclined to think that it was designed.
You're talking with us. You have a child inside the compound right now. Your thoughts as you're watching this. Mrs. Ganim, are you with us? Well, as you can see, the parts of the building have collapsed. The fire has indeed engulfed the vast majority of this compound that has been
The entire roof is gone.
The entire roof is gone. Mike, what else can you tell us? Any sign of firefighting equipment?
None whatsoever. And there's our shot from, you'll remember, Bonnie, what we refer to as farm cam. That's looking from the north side into the compound. Apparently, the north side is not involved yet. But it appears the rest of the compound is filled with that orange fire and acrid black smoke.
Also, within the past 10 days, past week, federal with razor-sharp concertina wire to prevent people from running out. That may, in this case, appear to be hazardous.
Still no sign of anyone coming out, Bonnie.
Mike, at this point, the latest figures we have is that there are 95 people inside. Of them, 17 below the age of 10. A total of 25 below the age of 18. Now with us on the phone is a member of the Branch Davidians speaking from prison. Go ahead.
Is this Brad Branch?
Yes.
Mr. Branch, what have you heard about what has happened, and was this something that was predicted by David? Is this a plan?
This is a systematic character assassination by the FBI to eliminate all of the crime scene. Now they're finishing off the job right now. They're destroying the crime scene. America, this is the biggest lie that's ever been put before the American public ever. Bill Clinton wants to use a scapegoat like the Attorney General. You know, I don't buy it.
Mr. Branch, was there no plan? All right. Thank you very much, Mr. Branch, for joining us. Now, as you
Bonnie,
can see...
Bonnie, let me interrupt you just for a second. Off to the right side of the screen, you can see three or four people. Apparently, it looks like federal agents out there beside the building. Now, whether they have any... it appears there is some movement, some people outside of the burning compound, burning portion of the compound.
You're right, and they are dressed in the black SWAT outfits that are used by the FBI officials. We now have a closer shot of it. It is very difficult to see what they are doing.
And once again, let's point out that the pictures are shaky because it is very, very windy. And we have to remain on the pictures as close as we can. Havoc with our camera position.
Yeah. Yes, we do. We're requested by the FBI probably about 5 minutes ago or six, and they're en route now.
Were you given any type of heads up or any type of warning that something like this might happen? Were you on standby at all?
No, not today. We have been in the past, but we weren't today of any type. We had been in contact with the FBI and ATF, and they were to follow normal procedures and use 911 to get a hold of us.
Have you been seeing pictures of the compound? And if so, at what point can you still make fire and saving any of the building?
Well, the biggest problem there is the compound is out in the country. They use whales. Our equipment hooks up to fire plugs, and just like doing all the municipalities around, our engines do not have the capability to draft water. Therefore, we have contacted a satellite community, Bell Mead, and they're sending one or two units that do have the capability to draft water out of stock tanks, swimming pools, whatever the case may be. But
well, and the building right now is about 7-8 miles outside of Waco, Maine.
They'll probably have about a 8 to 10 minute to 12 minute ETA.
from now or from 2 minutes ago when you sent them off?
Yeah, probably about 3 minutes ago. So they're probably still probably at least a good 10 or 12 minutes away.
Mike Capps, are you able to see any more people outside?
Not from this vantage point, Bonnie. All we can see is some Chinook helicopters. If we could pan back over toward the fire, or perhaps cut to a shot over there, could we do that, please? Thank you. From this vantage point, it'll probably be hard, Bonnie, to spot anyone coming out. Those Chinook helicopters will be used as medevac equipment, as we're told. This fire is completely out of control, and as the chief said, obviously they won't be able to do much except perhaps put out some smoldering embers there, it appears, and still no indication, no sign that anybody is coming out.
Mr. Wilson, are you still with us? Okay, I understand he's not. Still no word on whether or not any additional ambulances have been sent into the scene. Clearly, federal officials from the start were always prepared to evacuate a small number of wounded to hospitals in Waco. There's also the Fort Hood facility where we were told David Koresh and some of his others would also be taken. However, this situation has certainly changed that. Sonia, I understand you have a guest with you.
Yes, thank you, Bonnie. We're going to go now to Robert Klotz, who used to be in special operations for the D.C. police. He ran the helicopter squad, the bomb squad, and the presidential security unit. Now, Mr. Klotz, we are all watching this. We heard that this is a non-lethal form of tear gas. And the big question at the moment is, did the gas ignite this fire? Or is there something else that's responsible for it?
Well, I can't say with certainty that it did not. There are certain types of tear gas that when you, the methodology that you use can ignite a spark or create a fire.
Now, we know this is CS gas and that it was administered through an M5 dispenser. Tell us what that means and how that might add to the information.
Okay, an M5 dispenser is merely a larger vehicle for emitting the gas. It's usually run by a gas motor, something of that type. If that was on a tank and it was being...
Let me mention to you, Mr. Klotz, if you were watching, we just saw an explosion that came from one side of this building. So obviously there are things that are igniting even as we speak.
Keep in mind there's heavy munitions and heavy arms in there.
Right,
Mike, thank you.
I understand that part of that building had a lot of munitions in it, and that may be what you have just been looking at. The rapidity in which that fire took hold and the rapidity in which it spread seems to indicate to me that there had to be some kind of fluid or liquid in there. I've been at places where through the delivery of tear gas, a fire had one spread as rapidly as that, engulf as many buildings and as quickly as that.
Plus, could I ask you, Bob Ricks, the FBI special agent in charge in the news conference, said that this was non-pyrotechnic CS gas.
Okay, that means...
Can you explain what that means?
All right, that means that when it's introduced, there should be no spark or nothing that could create a fire. In some of the other methods, if you use a what they call a baseball grenade or a gas gun, where there's actually a spark created, but in a non-pyrotechnic... spark, so there should be no chance for fire.
Mr. Klotz, let me ask you, as you look at all these pictures, I mean, could anyone survive this if they were anywhere in the perimeter of the scene that we are seeing right now?
Well, if there are underground bunkers, etc., as I have heard, depending on what type of air system they have, if it's an independent air system, somebody could exist. If they're in any of those structures, time ago.
What about the heat, Mr. Klotz? I mean, how far down and...
You got to understand that I'm an ex-policeman, not an ex-fireman, so I'm not... reason they tell the fire and crawl is that heat tends to rise and the smoke doesn't go down too low. So it would seem to me if they were in a bunker which had a separate ventilation system, their chances would be better. I don't know what they have there.
Let me ask you about gas masks. We understand that they have gas masks available. How long does a gas mask last?
Gas mask is merely filters out the tear gas. It doesn't contain any self-contained oxygen that would help somebody if the problem was lack of oxygen. The only thing a gas mask has is a filter to filter out the tear gas or whatever it's, or the smoke.
Thank you for that. Let's go back to near Waco and to CNN correspondent Mike Capps. Mike?
Sonia, there's a couple of points to make here. Keep in mind, we're a mile and a half away from this fire, almost 2 miles, really, with an 800-millimeter lens. Smoke is billowing 150, 200 feet into the air. And also keep in mind, this is an area the size of a city block that's on fire. We are not talking about a small fire here. This is a big blaze and a hot blaze, and we've, as you pointed out a few moments ago, we've seen an explosion. So this is obviously a very dangerous situation.
Mike, as you said, that explosion came from the area in the compound where FBI officials suspected the weapons and explosives were being held. Now, it's very clear from talking with the fire chief and also from sources within the FBI that they were not expecting this. As we had reported earlier, the scenario called for tear gas to be inserted using various tracked vehicles. And in the best case scenario was that everyone would come out within 15 minutes. The worst case scenario, the worst thing they imagined in terms of planning this operation was that it would take 2 hours for the people to come out. So clearly this was not part of the plan. They did not have fire trucks standing by. They were not expecting an explosion of this magnitude and a fire of this magnitude. And so certainly, you know, it must be, at this point, very difficult to figure out what to do next.
Plus, we're into the seventh hour of this instead of the second hour.
Absolutely.
It seems like the smoke is nowhere near as thick as it was. However, the fire is still rolling. Mentioned a moment ago about the structural unsoundness of these buildings, and it's pretty obvious. Both while watching the M60 vehicle back in and out, and then seeing how the fire just raced through here, and let's give the wind a little bit of blame here, because it is extremely windy, as we've pointed out repeatedly here all day long, and that just made the situation even that much worse.
Now, Mike, this has been going on, as you said, about 6.5 hours ago. For the moment now, though, some local cable operators will be cutting away for a commercial message at this time, but CNN live coverage of developments in Waco continues. As you can see, a large part of the compound, the Branch Davidians complex, known to them as Mount Carmel, is in flames. We have seen a number of explosions. The flag, however, continues to fly. Tactical officials with the FBI did tell me that one reason they never knocked down the flag, information to sharpshooters. It could provide the strength of the wind and the direction of the wind should sharpshooters ever be called upon. So that is one reason why that flagpole has not been knocked down. Mike, are any of the third or fourth level floors of the compound, are they still standing?
It doesn't appear to be. None of my shot. And from my vantage point, it appears that everything that was above the second level is gone, except the water tower appears to be. You mentioned some underground tunnels and the possibility of a bunker.
For those viewers rejoining us following a local commercial break, CNN is bringing you live coverage of developments in Waco, Texas. We also remind you that we have coverage of developments in Waco. Mike, can you give us an update?
Yes. What you're seeing is the Branch Davidian compound that's been under siege for the past 51 days. It is engulfed in flames. What happened was, about 6 o'clock this morning, that time began pumping tear gas. The flag has just fallen there along the branch, in front of the Branch Davidian compound. Federal agents began poking holes in the side of the building and pumping tear gas in there. They relented for a while, but steadily continued to pump tear gas. About 50 minutes ago, M60 of what appeared to be the front portion of the south portion of the building.
Wow.
Still more tear gas, and then we saw flames break out, and wind blew and blew and blew, and the flames steadily spread throughout the compound. And this has taken us.
Mike, as you mentioned, shortly before, federal officials began using the tracked vehicles to poke holes into the walls and to insert the tear gas. According to a special agent charged with loudspeakers, the 95 people, according to Koresh, and they said, quote, "This is not an assault. Do not fire. We're introducing a non-lethal tear gas. Exit the compound now and you will not be harmed. Come out and you will be provided medical attention." Of course, no one took them up on the offer, and at this point there's no word on where the 95 people, that includes some 25 people under the age of 18, where they are now, and if indeed they're in some sort of underground bunker or not.
And Bonnie, we need to point out again, the only vision of humanity we've seen outside this place, in black, apparently a SWAT team, FBI men outside. And I
screen now to the left of the tracked vehicle. You can see some of the FBI agents. Now that one person did exit the compound with his hands up and that he has been taken into custody. But as of now, Ninety-four people now on the screen. Once again, you can see one of the federal agents standing on the tracked vehicle quite close to that compound in the burning building.
Aside from that, Bonnie, you pointed out, I believe it was in the lower right-hand portion of the screen where you saw that FBI agent a moment ago.
Yes, it was. David Koresh, throughout this entire siege, has told federal authorities, and they have passed on until he had a message from God. This was, of course, what delayed the entire process on the third day of the siege, when Koresh had promised to come out after the playing of a 58-minute message. Federal officials were at the ready. They had the hospital prepared. They were going to take in the three or four wounded members of the cult, Koresh included, but then nothing happened. David Koresh explained he had been told by God to wait, and that he would not come out until God told him to come out.
Bonnie, we are seeing the first Waco fire truck go past us even as we speak. Now this has been some 45 minutes after the fire broke out. The fire chief, led in by a Department of Public Safety trooper. And here comes the first pumper truck from the Waco Fire Department, two pumper trucks actually. And they'll be coming past they're coming past the compound, into the compound right now. You can see them entering. But as the fire chief told us a few moments ago, there's not a whole lot his men can do, his firefighters can do at this juncture.
There is no, the compound is not hooked up to the city water supply, and indeed the only water available comes from a lake that is on the property, the 77-acre ranch. The pump, however, has been disabled. Now, with us now is CNN's Flip Spiceland, who gives us an idea of how weather would play a role in a fire like this. Flip?
Well, Bonnie, we just, here at the CNN Weather Center, just checked our computer and found that it is a very, very windy area, but you can look at the video and tell that. Wind speeds are from the south at about 17 miles an hour currently, but that is a sustained wind. The winds have actually been picking up throughout the morning hours, and we have been seeing wind gusts near 30 miles an hour all morning long. And again, indications are that's actually getting windier rather than calming down. So we expect wind speeds of up to 30 miles an hour throughout much of the afternoon. Bonnie.
Thanks, Flip. About 4 or 5 weeks ago, Special Agent Bob Ricks did say, quote, we own the compound. And one thing that we can tell you now is that agents, federal agents indeed, were constantly in position within 50 feet of the compound, and that federal officials were also employing a very high-tech robot of sorts that had 7 cameras and was able to peek in windows 2 or 3 stories high by elevating a pole with the cameras inside. We know from our sources that the Branch Davidians were aware of the robot, but were not sure of its capabilities and therefore did not attack it in any way. Mike, what's the latest? Have you been able to see the fire trucks get to work?
Yes, Bonnie. We have a picture of the fire trucks entering the area where the FBI agents have been, and it's still going to take them a couple of minutes to get up over to the compound itself to even begin to put what little water they have access to on that fire. If this is like a normal pumper truck, they're probably carrying 350 to 500 gallons of water on board, and that's it. And that's not much to pour on any kind of a fire, let alone one of that magnitude.
On the phone with us right now is Ken Hines, who's a fire protection specialist. Mr. Hines, as you're watching these pictures, what could you come up with? What sort of plan? Is there a plan that fire officials could use now?
Well, I'm sure that the fire department have been in contact with the federal authorities in terms of something like this occurred. As you mentioned, in terms of fire protection and try to extinguish the fire department has to bring their water with them. So in a situation like this, what they would do would be to try to find an external water source in a location that would protect their firefighters if there would be any type of gunfire involved or anything like that, and establish a water supply, what we would call a relay pump, providing water to those fire engines right at the scene to deliver the water. The building's collapsed. The threat to the firefighters right now, I would assume, would be the tense situation in terms of is the scene secure? Is there anybody inside that may do harm not only to law enforcement but also the firefighters?
Well, as you can see in the live pictures, there's virtually a drastic difference from what we saw just about an hour ago.
Right.
Given the fact that there are also explosives inside, that must also add an entirely new and different element to fighting such a fire.
Well, in a situation like this, the fire department in Waco won't send anybody in. We in the fire service call this strictly a defensive fire. They'll set up their master streams on the top of the fire trucks, much like you saw in Los Angeles a year ago during the riots, and they'll apply large volumes of water to extinguish the fire. They may leave those unmanned, move their firefighters to the opposite side of where the fire is if there are any projectiles from explosives or ammunition catches inside the building. That would protect those firefighters. Now, the danger to firefighters comes into play when they're trying to drag hose lines or things like that. I would imagine, obviously, they're going to position their equipment upwind and do the best they can. In terms of a fire operation and tactics involved, they'd be there for a great deal of time doing the salvage and overhaul to make sure the building's out. Now, I heard you ask earlier about the bunker, and the law enforcement official was correct that the fire burns up and the heat burns up. As the building collapses, that would prevent any escape from the bunker, at least on the top of the building.
About the underground bunker, can people survive if they're in that underground bunker underneath what is happening right now?
Well, I don't know that much. I've watched your coverage for the last 45 days, and I don't know the construction or the type of ventilation system they have. No one can survive smoke products if they're exposed to them unless they have what we call self-contained breathing apparatus or the air bottles that the firefighters wear on their back. If there's some type of filtration system or it has an airtight system that draws air, maybe from another location rather than around the fire, I would imagine they could survive. But nobody can survive the products of fire or smoke.
Mr. Hines, please stand by for just a moment. I'd like to ask you some more questions, but first, Cheryl Atkinson is with us with some late-breaking news.
Well, Bonnie, this report, the White House says that according to its Justice Department, the cult members apparently set that fire that is consuming the compound near Waco, Texas. Of course, there was no way to know for certain how that fire started, the speculation that it had come from inside, and now the White House is quoting its Justice Department people as saying the cult members did set that fire. Bonnie?
Mr. Hines, just judging by how quickly it spread, was it your belief as well that this was not just a fire that spread and its natural progression, but was indeed perhaps aided?
Well, the fire folks in Waco, or the county around Waco, could provide you more information as to the construction of the building, but it appeared to be ordinary wood construction, and As I saw the fire unfold, I don't know whether there was some type of an accelerant or they set the building to burn. That would be something that could be determined by the alcohol, tobacco, and firearms folks along with the state agency down there. But it definitely was burning with a great deal of ferocity.
At this point, what kind of effect could two fire trucks have on this? I mean, it appears that there is virtually no building left. What steps would they take now to try to perhaps go into the bunkers?
Well, I would imagine that the strategy that the fire folks there would use, and not to put words in their mouth, I don't like to second guess anybody, but that they would start there on the upwind side and work their way back, extinguishing the fire under protection of the law enforcement folks. I can't imagine them pulling any hand lines off or getting into any type of hand line advancement until the area has been secured. That's just not good tactics for firefighters and for until the scene's secured.
Mike Haps, are you on with us?
Yes, I am, Bonnie.
Mr. Hines, if you will stay with us, just to see if we can get an update from Mike Haps, who is in Waco on the scene.
Okay, that's fine. I also have a question for him before we go. It appears that there was a lot of heavy black smoke, and you mentioned an accelerant. If, in fact, the cult members did start this fire, what are you talking about in terms of an accelerant?
Well, as you saw the fire burn, it was very heavy black smoke. Now, that's pretty common for any type of a structure fire, because what that is, those are the products that your couches, your chairs, your nylon-based products will give off heavy black smoke. That's pretty common. Anything that's a petroleum-based fire will give off heavy black smoke also, whether it's diesel fuel burning or gasoline or anything like that. I don't know what the products were inside the building. I didn't see any explosions. I didn't see any type of what would give the indication of, like, rocket shells or anything like that exploding. So
Since we've been chatting, we did have, you and I started chatting, there was an explosion right before the firefighters went in there.
Mm-hmm.
And they are in there now. We've seen the fire trucks come up and in there, so they must feel reasonably secure that the scene itself is secure.
Yeah, and I'm sure that, as I mentioned before, I'm sure that the fire department had an operational plan worked out with the federal authorities and the state authorities. In the event something like this would occur, and I can see the firefighters here on the screen in front of me that they're advancing some hand lines to the area where they are has to be secure.
Mm-hmm. How much manpower are you talking about to operate two trucks like that? That's not a very big manpower commitment.
Well, normally complement would be 3 to 4 persons per truck. Looked like a chief's car rolled in, which probably contained maybe 2 or 3 firefighters or command officers to interface and liaison with the federal authorities, and I'm sure that the fire department also has someone there at the federal command post to try to control what they do. You can see the firefighter there in front of you has the self-contained breathing working.
If there are 90 people, it would probably be nearly impossible to handle that many folks. That's a substantial problem that they would have medically. I'm sure Houston may be able to take some, and possibly San Antonio as well.
I would suspect that the agents who are near the building also face a tremendous amount of potential harm, either to smoke inhalation or to burns. What could you tell us about that kind of situation?
Well, the potential victims from a smoke inhalation would not need a specified burn unit. The injuries from smoke inhalation can mainly be managed in a different type of unit than a specialized burn care unit. But the fire victims themselves, the folks that have been burned obviously need to go to a specialized burn care center.
Is there anything that can be done immediately if indeed more people come out of the compound? Is there any treatment that should be given to them immediately, something that could forestall further injury?
Well, in the immediate period on the compound grounds, probably the best thing they could do would be to establish once they've put the fire out would be establish some intravenous fluids and give the patients oxygen and then get them to the nearest facility. That's about all you can do. As long as the patients have adequate oxygen and IV fluids, they should be fine for a length of time to enable them to get to a facility.
Dr. Bond, thank you very much for joining us. Mike Capps on the scene in Waco. We've seen a lot of helicopter activity. Any visible evidence, any evidence that indeed anyone is being evacuated?
None that I've seen, Bonnie. And just to further clarify a point here, probably the nearest, closest burn center to Waco would be Brooke Army Medical Center in San Antonio, and they offer probably quicker care than they could receive in Galveston, Galveston being a little further, but all great facilities. We're just seeing helicopters here. It looks like they're pouring something from the helicopter, or perhaps they're just looking over the area and seeing if there's any indication of life anywhere. It's hard to tell from this vantage point, but these helicopters have been up circling probably the last 5-6 minutes.
All right. Right now, CNN's Wolf Blitzer is at the White House with the latest from Washington. Wolf, what can you tell us?
Well, over here at the White House, we just had a briefing, and White House officials are saying, quoting the Justice Department, that they believe the fire was set inside, that it was not set from the outside. White House officials say they don't have any other additional specific information on the cause of the fire, but the president, of course, is closely monitoring the situation. White House Communications Director George Stephanopoulos says the president was informed of the operational plan on Sunday when he spoke by telephone with the Attorney General Janet Reno. She informed the president that the FBI did have a plan in mind. She provided, in about a 15-minute conversation, the details of the plan, most of the details. The president, according to Stephanopoulos, did not have any objections. And, of course, as a result, the plan was authorized and went forward. The president, of course, because this is the responsibility of his administration, the Justice Department, which oversees the FBI, the president, of course, takes full responsibility for whatever is unfolding in Waco right now. But, again, the news from the White House is that the Justice Department, which oversees the FBI, has informed the White House that the fire was set inside. And, of course, we will be monitoring that situation as it unfolds over here at the White House. Bonnie?
Wolf, FBI agents told us early on that for the first 10 days their hands were tied because there was no attorney general. Have you heard the same thing? And if indeed you have, is this an indication then that Janet Reno is also agreed to go along with this plan?
Yes, of course. Janet Reno is in charge of the FBI because she's the attorney general. There is an FBI director, Judge William Sessions, and of course his plan is the one that was put into place this morning, but Janet Reno clearly authorized it. She then had this telephone conversation with the president on Sunday, and because the president did not object to it, it was automatically authorized. The president could have raised objections, could have raised questions, could have delayed this operation. We do know, though, for several weeks, White House officials, other administration officials were very concerned that we're hoping that this situation in Waco could be resolved peacefully without additional loss of life. One of the great concerns, of course, being the initial loss of life in the unsuccessful ATF raid that took place, as we know, some 50 or so days ago. But there's no doubt that the White House and other agencies here in Washington, the Justice Department, the FBI, Treasury, which oversees the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, all of these officials were losing patience, and they wanted to see this situation resolved. Once this plan was presented to the president and to Janet Reno, it got the blessing and has been put into place this morning.
One thing that we also heard repeatedly from tactical officers on the field was that they had indeed presented numerous tactical plans to Washington, and that the plans were repeatedly turned down. There was some animosity on the part of the tactical agents on the ground, saying that they didn't think that politicians should get involved in this kind of tactical operation. Had you all picked up, did you pick up on this type of animosity at all?
Yes, and that's not all that unusual, given the nature of these kinds of operations. Usually, tactical operational personnel on the ground are much more eager to do something, and there's very often a political restraint that comes from Washington. We do know that Secretary of the Treasury, Lloyd Bentsen, spoke out publicly about 10 days or so ago on the need for patience, on the need for any of these operational plans to be fully coordinated with Washington. he did not want a repeat of the initial operation that resulted in the loss of life. There's also a sense, though, that at least here at the White House officials have consistently denied allegations coming from sources in Waco that the White House was supposedly micromanaging this operation. Officials here at the White House have repeatedly said that the president wanted to be fully informed. He wanted to know everything that was going on, but there was never a desire on the part of the president or any other senior officials at the White House to micromanage this. There was always a desire, though, at the Treasury Department and at the Justice Department to go ahead and micromanage it, and that's apparently what has been going on. But in the end, this latest plan that was put forward to Janet Reno, the Attorney General, was accepted by her. She informed the president, and he certainly gave the green light to go ahead with it.
All right. Thank you. Wolf Blitzer at the White House. Cheryl Atkinson joins us now with an update. Cheryl?
Well, Bonnie, as that fire appears to be dying down somewhat since the building is practically leveled, it appears, the information coming from the White House, according to wire service reports, is that two people were seen at the Colt compound near Waco starting the fire at opposite ends of the complex. And federal officials have apparently told the White House they believe the two people who started the fire at opposite ends of the complex are Colt members. And we see a tank going by at the bottom of the screen. So again, looking for exactly how the fire started, what was used to make it blow up into such a huge fire as it became. And now back to Bonnie Anderson.
Thank you, Cheryl. Now some local cable operators will be cutting away for a commercial message at this time. CNN live coverage of the Waco developments continues. For those viewers rejoining us following a local commercial break, CNN is bringing you live coverage of developments in Waco. We also remind you for an update of the day's news, you can tune to Headline News. Now let's return to CNN's live continuing coverage of events in Waco, where the compound, the Mount Carmel compound, where David Koresh and his followers has been burned. We understand now that indeed the fire, at least according to federal officials in Washington, was set intentionally. Mike Capps in Waco, what can you tell us? How can you update us?
Bonnie, CNN affiliate WFAA television from Dallas is reporting that two people came out of the compound, one with hands up, the other person apparently an agent who went in to get that person. So it's unclear now what the circumstances were, but apparently two people did come out at some point. We do not know who the cult member was. Obviously a cult member came out with his or her hands up. That all remains to be seen, that report coming from CNN affiliate WFAA. We're seeing activity. We see the M60 vehicles there alongside the fire trucks as they continue to watch the smoldering ruins of this fire. As the fire burned quickly.
A local commercial break. We are continuing with our live coverage of events in Waco. Joining us now is Cheryl Atkinson with an update. Cheryl?
Bonnie, to recap for those viewers who may be just tuning in to CNN, it is day 51 of the siege near Waco, Texas, and the standoff between the FBI and the Branch Davidian religious cult that now seems to be coming to an explosive and fiery end. Today's dramatic developments began shortly before dawn when the FBI apparently finally ran out of patience. CNN's Mike Capps has been closely following events and joins us now near Waco. Mike, it strikes me that we may never know, depending on the extent of this fire, exactly what happened. If there are bodies inside, it's believed that there may have been the initial shootout. How those people died, exactly how many munitions were inside. This was a terribly destructive fire.
We may never learn a lot of answers. That's exactly correct. I'm seen to prosecute anybody who survives this.
Mike Capps, we are getting a report now that according to Washington, there's an official saying that FBI agents were, of course, doing everything possible to rescue the cult members from the compound, but that at least 20 people may have gotten out of this cult compound. We haven't been able to see, by looking through our cameras, people running out or being rescued, but we did see agents going near the compound, and apparently, according to at least one source, at least 20 people may have gotten out of this destructive fire. At the time the fire started, one of officials said the FBI had no operation underway, but that FBI sniper at opposite ends of the compound starting this fire. It's not known exactly why the fire spread so quickly or what arrangements were possibly made by the cult members to make sure the fire would spread quickly.
Let me just say, Cheryl, from my vantage point, our vantage point here at the Satellite City, it's very difficult to see a lot of the goings-on because the brush is high or we're just so far away. So that could easily be the case. There could easily have been 20 people get out of there and then be placed on a bus on the other side of this place that we can't see and then having been taken out. Our cameras are manning the exits to this to the compound, and we continue to monitor that.
Okay, let's go to CNN's Bonnie Anderson, who of course spent a lot of time near Waco, Texas, waiting for this to unfold, and she's here with us now in Atlanta.
The fire has been burning now for well over an hour. Let's take a look at some of that earlier video. It started in one corner of the compound where there is a lookout tower. It's also a reception area there, and it was very close to where the weapons cache was believed to have been stored. It spread extremely quickly throughout the compound. At times, there were explosions as you smoke, and it was just a short matter of time before the vast majority of the compound in flames. There are reports now out of Washington that...
There's a number of things you can do to have fire spread that fast. They might have poured some type of gasoline or flammable product, diesel fuel, kerosene, anything like that, and preset the building to burn. Opened the doors, piled up bedding, and I heard you mention before in terms of the crime scene and processing that, the Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms is an excellent organization.
Excuse me for one quick moment. I do want to point out that we do see some agents, it appears, on the ground there, right next to the Bradley fighting vehicle that's going by now. They're right behind there. It could be as well that there are some cult members with them. We do have information that at least 20 of them have gotten out. Mr. Hines, if you would continue. I'm sorry for interrupting you.
In terms of, as a fire burns and as you mentioned, there's nothing left, but there's products of combustion, the petroleum products, and they can determine what was used to set the fire and can go back and reconstruct the building to see where the fire started from those eyewitness accounts and how the fire progressed, and come up with a pretty good accurate picture as to what happened inside there that nobody could see.
Well, to recap, there were 95 people inside the compound, according to David Koresh. This is information that he has provided to federal officials. 35 people have come out, plus two others, a total of seven. The other two were two men who snuck into the compound and were able to get past federal authorities, and they have indeed exited over the past couple of weeks. Now, among the 35 people, message on national television and radio networks, Koresh agreed to surrender. Buses were sent to the compound, but nothing happened.
Say that he had received a message from God instructing him to wait.
While agents waited with him, they cut off access to the outside world, disabling the compound's phones and satellite dish, cutting off electricity. Little by little, Koresh released 21 children, though he kept 17 others, many fathered by him, inside the compound, angering federal agents.
He's using them as a shield, which is cowardly. We believe if he truly cared about those children, that they would be released.
14 adults were also allowed to leave. The elderly are now in halfway houses, held as material witnesses, while many of the younger members are charged with conspiracy to murder federal agents. In chains, many professed love for Koresh and his teachings.
When God decrees it, sir.
Statements as, we are ready for war. Let's get it on.
As the siege entered its third week, the FBI... found over powerful loudspeakers, now and then playing recorded phone. Members knew what... Indeed, as the standoff dragged on, federal authorities worried Koresh might be planning a mass suicide.
So as he becomes more and more withdrawn and more delusional, we're still very much concerned that he may force his followers to do things that are not rational.
Agents believed Koresh's wounds might be clouding his judgment, but Koresh and one of his wives, whose hand was infected, refused to come out for medical help.
Her suggestion to the doctor was perhaps she should just cut off her finger.
After weeks of phone discussions with the leader about his beliefs, frustrated negotiators ruled Bible class was over.
To that extent, we've made it clear that we want to talk about substantive issues, not the various seals.
But several true believers from around the country were interested in Koresh's teachings. While a few were arrested attempting to sneak into the compound, two men made it by, to the great embarrassment of the FBI. As the fifth week began, it was evident federal forces were losing patience.
All he is a cheap thug who interprets the Bible through the barrel of a gun.
Indeed, the standoff was a series of ups and downs.
We're not talking long-term according to what he's saying.
We are cautiously optimistic.
When two attorneys agreed to meet with Koresh and his right-hand man, they and the FBI believed the end was near.
Hopeful that this is some real progress and that we can bring this thing to an end real quickly.
That effort failed, though the lawyers came out saying Koresh and his followers would surrender after Passover week. Wary agents waited once again and made alternate plans.
Regroup, and we'll have to decide what other arsenal.
From the start, FBI officials said they were prepared for any eventuality, but given the fact there were no fire trucks on the scene this morning, it is clear it was to torch their own building. The fate of those who remained inside at this point is still unknown. CNN's live coverage will continue after this. That this undercover agent was indeed an agent. They had made comments to him that were quite pointed, but they also allowed him to continue coming in. He even had weapons practice with them at times. So it was very clear that his cover had been blown, but as long as he was still allowed to go into the compound, he continued to go. Now on the line with us now is David Jewell, whose ex-wife is in the compound. Mr. Jewell's daughter was also a member, I believe a teenage daughter, and recently got out of the compound. You were very worried about your daughter before you left. Did you ever imagine something like this would happen?
Well, first of all, I was never in any way affiliated with the group. My sole connection with them has been in context of getting my daughter away from them. Had they had their will, my daughter would have been inside that fire today.
You once spoke, and you had on the phone with David Koresh, and the power you felt he had over people. Can you recount that for us?
He is, without question, a powerful man, if in no other way than that he has or had the capacity to your weaknesses were your emotional or psychological weaknesses and capitalizing on those. I came from a very fundamentalist Christian home, was raised with religion being a very strong part of my upbringing, and as a result had very deep-seated religious viewpoints. And within 20 minutes of being on the telephone with him, he had found a way to make me question everything I had ever believed in, to the extent that my own sister, who knows me probably better than certainly most people, if not anyone, was fearful that I was going to go and join the compound for a period of a week or so thereafter. He has had an incredible ability to sort of turn your head around and make it very difficult for you to think clearly.
As you've watched the live pictures this morning, certainly there must be some very distressing moments for you. Has your daughter seen the coverage? Is she aware of what has happened at Mount Carmel today? And if so, how is she taking it?
Yes, she's very, very much aware of what has happened today. And I would have to say that at least on the surface, she appears to be taking it much better than I am, even. She has said from the very beginning, although we have not said anything publicly because we didn't want to influence events, she has indicated from the beginning that there was no way those people were ever coming out peacefully and that this would end in some kind of a destructive conclusion.
With her mother inside the compound, this must be then a very difficult day for her.
It is. It absolutely is.
Mr. Jewell, thank you very much for joining us. Cheryl.
Bonnie, thank you. We do have some new information to report. A spokesman for Attorney General Janet Reno says that 8 cult members are in federal custody near Waco today. The spokesperson says 2 of those cult members have admitted they are the ones who started. Government agents say cult members started the fire that incinerated the building about 3 hours ago. According to Koresh's numbers, there were 95 men, women, and children inside. Justice Department sources tell CNN just 8 people, 7 men and 1 woman, survived the fire. Their identities haven't been revealed, but those sources right now are saying David Koresh is not among the survivors. 4 of the survivors are injured, 2 seriously. They're being taken to hospitals in Waco and Dallas. This isn't the way government agents wanted the 51-day-old standoff to end. Early this morning, armored vehicles rumbled through a hail of cult gunfire, punching holes in the compound's walls and pumping tear gas into the buildings. FBI agents then settled back, waiting for David Koresh and his followers to come out. Hours went by, and then this afternoon, fire and smoke began pouring out of the buildings. The fire spread quickly, causing explosions and destroying the compound as stunned agents and viewers around the world watched.
We get the latest now from the scene of the disaster. We go live to CNN's Mike Capps.
Good afternoon, Lou. Questions remain unanswered 3 hours after that blazing fire roared through the Branch Davidian compound 12 miles outside Waco, Texas. The Justice Department says 2 cult members have admitted setting that fire. But there are differing reports circulating concerning the number of survivors. First we heard 20 to 30, then we heard the number 7, then 10. And now authorities seem to have settled on 8 to sort this out. For now, let's take...
As you can see on your screen, there is a great deal of smoke coming out of the building. Let's go to Mike Capps. We can also see some flames there now. Mike, what can you tell us? What can you see?
Well, Bonnie, for the last 15 minutes, we've watched this M60 vehicle, this combat engineering vehicle, make large holes in the side of this building and pump tear gas in there. At times, as you well know, tear gas can be incendiary, and apparently this is what's happened. And it looks like now we have a very large-scale fire breaking out on what must be the south side, right near the front side of this building. These are some amazing pictures here. A fire has broken out, and let's just stay with this and watch it for a few minutes if we can. As I said, this combat engineering vehicle has been working very diligently around the front door of the complex, and First he'd take his shovel in and scoop something out. Then he'd turn around with the turret and pump tear gas in. And
Mike, it appears that this is the portion of the building that is on fire right now is part of an observation tower that is adjacent to the front door. It's also on the second floor, which is where the women's sleeping quarters are.
This fire is really burning out of control here.
Well, and we also have to remind viewers that water has been turned off. The water pump does not work at the facility. It has been disabled by the FBI about the second week of this raid.
Now, and also remember, we've had 35 to 40 mile an hour winds, and this fire is...
from below, trapped under the rapid fire, unable